un des rêves de ma vie. Et c'est extra-professionnel, ça, n'est-ce pas? Le rêve de ma vie, c'était d'avoir la femme que j'ai et de réussir la vie commune que nous avons réussie.
My life's dream was to have the wife I have and to succeed in our life together as we have. I think we've been remarkably successful, the two of us. We have the impression, with respect to each other, that our life together has been a great success. And there are quite a few who'll vouch for that.
It was a couple that was very, very, very much in love. I can remember coming back from university. I wasn't a kid anymore, like I was in my early 20s. And finding mom and dad on the living room couch, just kissing, just having a good time. I guess it does set a reference and a standard. And we are, I guess, quite lucky to have had the chance of having parents that were very much in love. There's been like a lot of love, but a lot of complicity. I don't find an English equivalent for this word. I mean, it's part of reading in one another's mind, sharing objectives, sharing a vision of life, wanting to make things happen together, but just not needing words, just a look or just a glance.
Nadia remembers building houses under the piano with her brother and sister while her father was composing. He had the ability to concentrate through all the mayhem. He may have seemed totally absorbed, but if one of the kids wanted his attention, they would just have to say Jean in a certain way, and Dad would snap out of his composer's trance. Nadia's parents complimented one another. Isabel was a student of history, a ballerina, and as joyful and outgoing as her husband was deep and introspective. Yet recalling his old colleague, John Rea reminds us that Papineau-Couture was at heart a sharp-witted and funny man.
Had a very clever sense of humor. He was also self-mocking. I always enjoyed it because I am still a member of the artistic committee of the SMCQ, and he was there in the early years of the 80s when I was there for a number of years. And he had ways of using the French language that would twist the meanings, a kind of punster type of. And then he would become very, very serious when somebody had, let's say, written a text for the minutes of a meeting or something like that. He would be absolutely picky. He said, you know, this word is not spelled correctly, and that word is in an inversion with another word, and this is not the appropriate. It was like very, very meticulous. And of course, this always elicited laughter because he would be mocked by the younger members, naturally, for being fuddy-duddy or being the dean, you see, for being the dean. It's said that people who are punsters often are good as composers. I've heard this before. Stravinsky was certainly a punster. And it has something to do with sound, of course, and double meaning. And music is always filled with double meaning.
You know, he was somebody thinking fast. You know, it was not a turtle. You know, he was more a rabbit than a turtle. And he liked always to play with words, you know, faire des jeux de mots. Et puis, you know, when we had, you know, this teaching with him, it was almost a joke from the beginning to the end of the class. But we learned things through that, you know. It was not too serious. In the bad meaning of the word, there was an expression at the time of Rabelais, le gai savoir. Le gai savoir is a joyous knowledge. So I think Papineau-Couture was a very joyous teacher.
Oh, Jean was a very lively man. He was very enthusiastic, very committed. Sometimes I also had the feeling that he's a bit opinionated.
About what kinds of things?
Well, as far as musical taste, well, serial music was not, I'm not interested in it. He's violently against it. On principle or on what grounds, I don't know. It was a commitment which not only said, well, I have nothing for that, and that doesn't interest me. It was, one should not be interested in that, and I don't understand you why you are interested in that. So it was not only an exchange of information, it was a debate.